Good evening, everybody. It's a privilege for me to welcome our Professor Jai Prakash Reddy. Dr. Reddy is a very well-known otologist in Andhra Pradesh from Kurnool. He is doing this temporal bone workshop and some workshop since almost 10 years now. And we have usually conduct 3 to 4 workshops and some workshop. You know, as an otologist, and I thank Sri Arsha for giving us an opportunity to conduct this webinar. Thank you, Sri Arsha. As an otologist and a student of otology, we come across a lot of ear cases. And before we jump into the surgery, we should have a real practice on the temporal bone. So temporal bone dissection becomes a prime importance, to carry on our routine surgeries in the operation theater. So the temporal bone dissection, when we conduct at Dr. Jai Prakash Reddy, when we do a temporal bone, it will be similar to what we do it in the operation theater table. So we should know how to fix the temporal bone in the beginning and how to adjust the microscope. Basically we should able to see on both the eyepieces. You should have a binocular vision. So Dr. Reddy probably will be explaining you how to do that. Binocular vision is very important because you will know the depth when you change the magnification. And especially when you use the drill, you should know what type of drill you should supposed to use, what is the speed at what area, and main important is the burr bit, drill bit. So particularly when you drill an outside cortical bone, what size of drill bits you're supposed to use, and the shaft length how you're supposed to use, the different types of burrs, depending on the particular area of dissection. So now, with this small brief introduction, let me hand over to Dr. Jai Prakash Reddy. Dr. Reddy, you're on.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Dr. Govindraj. Before I start my presentation, I would like to thank this Dr. Harsha and his friend for doing such a wonderful programs, and they are taking a lot of pains to spread the knowledge, and we want to be part of it. So when he asked me to speak on temporal bone dissection, I said that we will have in 3 sessions, because the first lecture what you are going to be with us today is the basic temporal bone dissection, what all we require to do, the tools that we have to have in our hand, and then how to use the tools for effective dissection. That's what is going to be today's talk. So tomorrow we'll talk on, the next session will be on half of the exercises, how we do, and then the next later in the Wednesday. So for today's talk, we'll be having basics of temporal bone dissection and the drilling techniques and the tools what we use and what we should know about them. That's what is the agenda today. So I request all the viewers to note my email ID. So if you have any doubts which can't be cleared right now, can be cleared through any time, you can ask. So you can just take a note of my email ID. So with this, so we'll go for the... Yeah. Hello?
Yeah, Reddy, you're on. You can go ahead, because others can't communicate to you.
Yeah. So first, let us ask ourselves, sir, why should we do temporal bone dissection? That is the first thing that we must know. So because there are so many specialties are there, so they don't do any cadaveric dissections most of the times. And we do cadaveric dissections for the simple reason that our area, that is the middle ear and inner ear, are situated in an area where a lot of important structures are surrounding them. And first of all, our own middle ear is a very delicate and fragile structures, wherein we'll be using a lot of fine, sharp instruments along with a high-speed drill. So because of these reasons, we must have a three-dimensional anatomy in our mind before we go on to surgery. And we must also understand what are the changes that we see when we use the drill on different parts of the temporal bone. And we must also know what are the areas that are going to bleed when you operate. So these are the things made us to understand that we have to do a temporal bone dissection. So that is a very important thing that for the ENT surgeon, aspiring ENT surgeon. So then what are the ways that we learn to learn the temporal bone anatomy is that, so first of all, we must study the temporal bone anatomy, osteology and a dry temporal bone first. Then you have to understand that when you do dissection of temporal bone, they are different from surgery because there is no disease when you do temporal bone dissection and there is no bleeding, there is no patient. And we have to learn the surgical anatomy under the microscope. And also the tools what we use in temporal bone dissections are very important, that we must get used to them. We must get used to the microscope. We must get used to the drill. We must get used to all the instruments that we use. So if you know how to use the instruments and how to handle the instruments, you are half the surgery is done. Then you can, one thing that you have to understand, that we cannot become an instantaneous surgeon by attending one webinar or by attending one temporal bone dissection course or by seeing a surgery in the YouTube. You have to understand that it takes a lot of many hours to do a dissection, to understand the anatomy first. So we always advise the juniors to do dissection of the temporal bone and the dry bone first, because dry bones are easy to get. It's not impossible, difficult to get. So then once you are familiar, then it is, you know, we all know that today there are a lot of laws and imposing that we must not use human parts used in the outside. There are a lot of issues going on. That is the reason today it is very difficult for us to get a dry, a fresh temporal bone from a cadaver. There are a lot of things out there. So then how do we conduct courses if you don't have bones with us? So that's a $1 million question. So you should have your own contacts. You must request people around you who are dealing with this cadavers and anatomy department to get the bones, and so that you can do the dissection. Of late, there are a lot of places we have courses, and there is a lot of scarcity and demand for the bones. So each temporal bone is like a gold, like for us. So we must not waste the bone. So we must we all know that cadavers are the main ones, are the ornamentarium for us, for the teachers of the, to teach the temporal bone anatomy. And there's nothing like hands-on dissection on the cadaver, where you can acquire dexterity of the drill to temporal bone and mastering its anatomy. Because after all, even if you do other way of learning are there. So if you don't have cadaveric bones, then what are the options that we have is that, number one is the simulation, which has come to a virtual reality. Nowadays, there are a lot of things are there. Then the safer alternatives are coming up, because many people believe that doing temporal bone dissection transmits some slow virus diseases and some other bony particles are there, biofilms are there, a lot of things are there. So there are alternatives are there, like one alternative is the simulation. Second alternative is the you do on a sheep temporal bone, and the best one is the Pettigrew bones. So these Pettigrew bones courses are being conducted in England. So we'll be just looking into that. These are the just alternatives. So way back in 20 years back in Glaxo, that is in the UK, they started this Pettigrew temporal bone. These bones are made with the synthetic material. They are just like human temporal bones. All the structures are incorporated into the bone, and there are ossicles, every facial nerve will be there. But this is not human. This is a prepared one by the chemical like thing. Okay, so this will be fitted into this temporal bone dissection holder like this. And this is the holder, that is the wooden block, which is fixed like this. So it will be just like a human temporal bone, but it is a synthetic one. So wherein they are conducting courses on this. And these bones are, once you are done with the normal bone dissection, then these bones are also available with the disease. If you want a bone with a cholesteatoma, you can get from them. And then you can do a modified radical mastectomy like this. and then you can reconstruct and do come out. And you can even do a tympanoplasty with this, because there are bones available with them. With the perforation, you can do tympanoplasty. Grafting also you can do. So all these things can be done with them. But only thing is they are expensive. These things are expensive bones available in Britain. They conduct courses like this, because in Britain and many of the places in Europe, dealing with human parts is not so easy as in our country. So this is a very good alternative, but expensive. So the next thing what we have alternative is the virtual temporal bone dissection. We have wherein, see, you'll be sitting in front of a computer like this, and you have a software, and wherein it will be like this, the software, and once you start this, so then the drill will start drilling the mastoid. And the feeling that what you get to your hand when you drill, you'll have the same feeling you will have to the hand. So if you commit a mistake here, it will show that you have hit the facial nerve or you have hit the dura or something like that. So it's a very good alternative to the temporal bone dissection. But the thing is, the software will be costing somewhere to the tune of 60 to 70 lakhs rupees, so which an individual cannot afford to have a software. So the best way is to the software, the institutions will have to buy the software. So this is it's not in our reach. Only one or two centers in India have this. We don't have this. But still, the best one is the human temporal bone dissection is an ideal according to everyone. So now, well, let's come to the what we are for today is the, let's see the, we'll start with the temporal bone holder. See, in the market, we get a lot of temporal bones of this sort and this sort. So these are 3-point fixation, this is the 4-point fixation, this is a 5-point fixation. So the ideal one is a 4-point fixation, which will sit on a ring like this. And this has got a stand, and it will move to any way that you wanted to move this, and you can fix the bone. So I cannot tell you what is an ideal bone holder, but which one suits for you better is the one that you have to choose. So I think these two are the good ones. They are available in the market. You can have them. This one is made of metal. Only thing is, once you use this, you have to wash and dry it. Otherwise, it is going to become rusted, and then these parts will become stiff. You cannot move that. You have to take care of this temporal bone holder. The next is, once you have the temporal bone holder, then you have to clean the bone this way. See, this is the surgeon's viewpoint. That means we must understand that as if the patient is lying down in front of you, the bone should be fixed. So now this is the left temporal bone. So all the soft tissue is cleared. You can see very nicely. And now it is ready to for surgery. Dissection, you can see the tympanic membrane intact here. The fresh temporal bone. So now at this point of time, I just want to make clear that what is anterior, what is posterior to us. So now, please.
Dr. Reddy.
Yeah.
Small interruption here.
Yeah.
See, before we should know how to harvest the temporal bone, can you please highlight a few points about harvesting the temporal bone from the cadaver?
There are some methods of dealing with that. Yeah. That is a core method and excision method. I don't know much about them, because we have these things will be dealt by the forensic people and anatomy people. So I don't have much idea about that, but I know there are 2-3 varieties of harvesting the bone from the cadaver.
The main thing is, when we try to get the harvesting the bone, especially for a temporal bone dissection, it should be of ideal size, so that even when they cut that, you know, you should see that the part of the bone get fixed to the bone holder properly. So you should have enough bone, like squamous part of the temporal bone should be enough, and the zygomatic.
Yeah, yeah. See, what we need to do is that we have to tell the people that who are going to give you bone, you must show what exactly you want, then they'll do for you. Yeah, what size you want. Because if they cut too much of size, it will be difficult for you to fit it to the temporal bone holder.
And too small also, it won't fit.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, good point.
And you should see that the soft tissue should be inside. Yeah. The bone should contain the soft tissue as well.
Yes, all these things should be cleared like this mastoid cortex. So now at this point, I want to make it clear that you have to know what is superior. So now whenever we say what superior in the temporal bone, it is towards the vertex. Please remember that superior, this is superior towards the vertex. Whenever we say inferior, this is towards our foot downwards. If you say towards posterior, this is towards the occiput. Whenever you say anterior, it is towards the face. Whenever you say it is medial, towards the brain. Whenever you say towards lateral, it is towards the exterior, that is towards the external canal and tympanic membrane. So these are the basics of temporal bone: superior, anterior, posterior, and inferior, medial, lateral. So this is the four things bones you must know. So once you fix this bone like this, then the next step is what you need to do is that you must adjust the microscope. The next important tool to us with which we are going to live for our life is the microscope. So the what microscope has got a stand which will sit on the stand floor will be there. So that will sit on this. So the main part is this. So today we have the light source in this microscope. Most of the times it is halogen. Now it is replaced by LED. LED light is the best one to have a very good image. It has a white light. So this is a on and off switch, and you can increase the intensity with this knob. And the next thing is that this is the suspension arm. The whole system suspension arm is the most important thing which will hold your optics. So now when you come here, so we have the holder of the microscope. You can hold this one with your both the hands and move. And we have this is a magnification changer, and this is a fine tuning will be there on the right side, and these are the eyepieces. So you must know what are the parts of microscope. So the now the most important thing is the objective lens. This is the lens, objective lens. What we use in our otology practice is 250 mm lens we use, because earlier days we used to have 200 mm lens. But the 200 mm lens, if you use the objective lens, means this is the focal length 250. This is 25 centimeters. You will be away from the, suppose this is the objective lens, our tissue will be here. So that means the distance between the place where you are going to operate and your lens will be 25 centimeters. That means to say that if you have 300 centimeter, the 30 centimeter, the 300 mm lens, it will be very lengthy for you to operate. The ideal one is 250. So now that is the lens. So then the most important things are these are the eyepieces. So what we have to understand with these eyepieces is that you see now, the moment you start the dissection or surgery, first thing what you should do is you must keep these eyepieces in the zero, both the sides, because this makes the microscope as an emmetropic. So some people do adjust their power on this microscope, but what is said ideally is that you keep them in the zero. And you use your own spectacles, whatever you are going to use. That is what we follow, and that is what has been advised. So that is the number one. Number two, that is the interpupillary distance. What is interpupillary distance? Is that when you see, now first what you do is, you on the microscope and then just focus it on an object in the low power, and then just see through the both the eyepieces. So now what you see is that you see one image as two images. So then you start moving the eye tubes together like this towards medially. Then slowly, once you start moving, then you will see at one point of time, you will see two images as one image. That is the place where your interpupillary distance is adjusted. That means if you don't adjust your interpupillary distance, what will happen is that you will see one object as two different objects through your eyes, and you will not have that depth perception. So the very important basic thing to use a microscope is to have a very good depth perception. If you want to get a very good depth perception, then what we need to do is we need to adjust your interpupillary distance, where at one point you will see two images as one, then that is your interpupillary distance, and your depth perception will increase. That's a very important thing. Every time you do surgery, you have to adjust your interpupillary distance. That is with the getting familiar with the microscope. So once you are familiar with the microscope, what is now very important is to, how do you sit to operate? So you must protect your back. Your back should be protected very well, because you are going to operate for many, many years. You should not develop back pain. So the biggest hurdle for a surgeon is the back pain. So we must all protect our back for a long years to go to operate, because we have to sit more than 2 to 3 hours, sometimes 4 hours to operate. So if you're having any back problem, it is not done. So you have to sit right. You should select a very good chair for that. And then always your feet should not hang in the air. It should be rested on the ground. If not ground, you order for a suitable stool, which should be tailor-made for your needs. And then so that your legs will just sit on the, it will stand on the, you will rest on the foot ground where you keep your drill control or diathermy and other things. And your hands should rest on the table. But here there is no hand rest, as you see here. My hands are in the air. So when my hands are in the air, what will happen that my finer movements cannot be adjusted properly. So that is very important. Whenever you do microsurgery, so now you see this chair. So this is the hand rest. My hand is going to rest on this when I do micro air surgery. So my hand will be steady. That's very important. The left hand also is going to rest on this. So it's a very good idea to invest on a chair like this to have a back support. See, this is a very good chair that I use for my surgery. So where this can be adjustable, all the sides. Height is adjustable. Then this is adjustable. This height of this backrest is there. It's a very good chair to invest so that you will not have developed back pain. This is very important to have one. So now, once you are done with the position of the... Well, let me have some water. Yeah, thank you. So when you know all those things about the microscope and sitting, so the next, the most important one of the today's talk is... Yeah.
Yeah, there's one participant asking for a question. Yeah. So his question is, how you maintain the microscope?
Means?
I mean, what is the care you should supposed to take for the microscope?
Yeah, see, microscope, see, that is very important thing is that when you operate, when you do surgery or dissection, what you need to do is you must use a cover for that. There's a covers are available. Some people keep formalin tablets, and when they don't use, but when they use, they remove the cover. And they don't use anything, just they use the microscope without any cover or anything. So what I suggest is that we have disposable covers which are made, sterile covers are made by the many people. So you can buy so that the blood will not touch the microscope. And we should always clean our lenses with the lens cleaning solutions are available with the microscope people. If you don't have that, just plain tap water. You just put it in the clean cloth and remove all the dust and other things. Another important thing what you need to do is that if you don't use microscope for many, many days, there will be a fungus formation in the lens. So now and then you just on your microscope. That's what is the care that you need to take for the microscope. Anything else you want to add, Govindraj?
Yeah, nothing else. We cover everything. So yeah, the very important thing is this, you know, especially when you drill, let it be a temporal bone or the patient, you feel a lot of bone dust sticking to the lens. So it's always better to clean the lens immediately, either with, as sir told about, whether you can use a saline or a best is this solution, lens solution.
No, saline you should not use, because saline contains salt crystals.
Salt, yeah.
It will form crystals over the lens. That is what exactly they are not supposed to do. They should take tap water.
Tap water or Savilon or best is...
No Savilon. This not only Savilon, lens. Lens cleaning solution is available.
Solution. That is the best option. Yes, that's always the best option.
Yeah.
The next one more question they asked is how to preserve the bone, whether it is dry or wet bone. I think dry bones, you can just keep it like that. Wet bones, usually we use a formalin solution, or sometimes we use a hyper concentrated sodium chloride solution. Like we put a salt and just water. You want to add anything ready for this?
Yeah, there's something called as buffered formalin. So the buffered formalin is not 100% formalin. You can make it into 20% formalin and you can preserve bones in that. But only thing is you should frequently check for any fungus formation or anything. You need to change it very often. See, that is what we are going to do. But the ideally how you should preserve the wet bones are that you should have a freezer. Freezers are the best way to preserve the bones. Whereas dry bones, if you want to dissect dry bones, they have to be soaked in water for 2 days prior to your dissection. That's the thing.
And one more question from Jamal Ju. What is the best ear model animal?
I think the sheep one is the best one because that is easy to get and the anatomy is near normal, near to the human, but it is very different anatomy, but at least it is easy to get and so you can have drill practice. Sheep head.
We have one more question, but that is regarding the drill. Should I go now? It is from Chaudhary Satyanarayan. He asked for precautions taken with high speed drill.
No. That we'll be discussing now. So
later,
now,
yes.
So what we do is now, Govind Raj, you can ask the, we'll discuss the questions. Once I finish the micromotors, then you can ask questions.
Sure.
Then drills, you can ask again. Okay?
Okay.
So now we have three types of micromotors available to us. So number one is the conventional one. The RPM means revolutions per minute. So the maximum speed of this conventional tool is 20,000 per minute. So the next one is we have brushless motors available in the market. So this is a very high speed drill. This is the very conventional one. So this is a mid zone brushless motors are the ideal ones for the ear surgery. So this RPM is around 40,000 RPM is there. And then high speed is up to 80,000 to 1 lakh RPM is there. But this is a high end. So now let's analyze the each one. Yeah, see, this is the basic micromotor that is used for the temporal bone dissection. And we have used the same system in the initial days of our practice for the ear surgery also. So 25 years back, having a micromotor was a luxury because that time majority of the people were doing ear surgery by a goose and hammer, followed by there is a hanging motor. The hanging motor was the one which produced a lot of sound and then it causes deafness to the surgeon. So the next came is the basic model. This is the marathon drilling machine, is a basic one. So this has got the four components. This number one is the controlling unit. So this has got on and off switch here. And backside, there is one more switch which can make your drill to turn clockwise and anti-clockwise. These are the two connections that they have had. Then the next one is this is a micro motor, which will be connected to this. And this is the foot pedal. Then the next one is this what you see is the hand pieces. So these are the four components of a drill system. So now a word about micro motor. This is a micro motor, which has got a below 20,000 RPM. So the next one is a foot pedal. So this foot pedal, there are two types of foot pedal available in the market. Number one is a normal foot pedal like this. Second one is a variable foot pedal. The variable foot pedal means when you press the foot pedal, it will move according to your pressure of the foot pedal. If you press too much, the drill will move to the full extent whatever you have kept here. Suppose this is from here to here, the maximum speed is there. We always keep it here. If you press the foot pedal to its maximum pressure, then the burr will rotate to its maximum capacity. So that is the advantage of variable foot pedal. So this is a normal foot pedal. So it has got four components, we know that. So now let's see how it functions. So the next level of drill system is a brushless motor, or it is an intermediate type of drill that majority of the people use. So now this, the RPM is around 60,000 RPM. Is there. So it has got a variable foot switch. So what is brushless motor now? What is a brushless motor? So now the brushless motor is the one motor. So you see, when I am operating with this drill system, when I press this, the drill start moving. When I don't want to drill, so I'll immediately remove my leg from the foot pedal. So then the burr will stop immediately and instantaneously the moment I stop pressing. So that is brushless motor. Whereas the conventional motor, this one, the disadvantage is when I don't want to drill, I'll remove my foot from the foot pedal. But still, the burr will move for some time, then only it will stop. That means to say that the brushless motor, the ordinary motor, when you don't want to drill, when you remove your foot from the foot pedal, still it continues for a while. before it stops. That's the disadvantage of normal motor. Whereas a brushless motor and high speed drill, it is a it will stop instantaneously as you touch. So these are the very good systems available. There are many, many systems are available in the market. This is the intermediate one. So the next we go for the hand pieces. So the hand pieces are available in two forms. There is number one is a straight hand piece. So these straight hand pieces are also available into short ones and long ones. And then we have contraangular ones. So the advantage of this contraangular hand piece is that when you want to work in a deeper planes like deep canaloplasty, or when you want to drill for the posterior tympanotomy and deeper plane, so you have to use a contraangular handpiece without you bending the handpiece too much into the field. So this is the advantage of contraangular handpiece. So now once you use the handpiece after surgery or temporal bone dissection, the most important thing is you have to lubricate the thing handpiece, because what we are using is produce a lot of friction, and then is the rotating part, actually is a motorized part. So it gets heated up, a lot of particles will be there. So once you spray this one, then it will become, the important thing is that the you have to take care that this spray should not go into your micromotor. Okay, the handpiece has to be lubricated, but the same oil should not go into the micromotor. If it goes into the micromotor will get spoiled. That's you have to take care. So then comes the high speed drill systems. There are a lot of high speed drill systems are there in the market now. So this is one of its kind. So the most important thing that we must understand is it runs between 60,000 to 80,000 RPM per minute. Okay, so we have to be very careful and vigilant when we use this type of drill. Just excuse me. Yeah, I'm sorry for the interruption. Yeah, so when you use this kind of drills in your practice, you have to be very careful that it may hit a place, so it will damage the surrounding structure. You should have very good drill control before. So we all use this type of drills in our practice to do surgery. So having a high-speed drill system is a luxury. So the next one is what we have is a Skeeter drill. So what is this drill? This is a very delicate drill which is used in when you on foot plate and when you want to do cochleostomy. It's a very fine drill which runs at a speed of below 1000 RPM, so that it will not damage the surrounding structure. It's a very, very good drill. You must have this when you do stapedectomy and cochleostomy. A very fine drill this is. So once we know about the drill systems available, then we come to the most important aspect of our talk today is the burrs. So before we go on to the burrs, Govindas, do we have any questions on the drill systems and hand pieces?
We have little few questions here.
Yeah.
Somebody wants to know about the brushless motor again.
Yeah. What they want to know?
Where is the routine one burr keep in rolling for some time? See, brushless, they did not understand what is the concept of brushless motor and brush motor.
Yeah. See, brush motor means when I am doing surgery, when I am doing temporal bone dissection, the common one, the basic one, when we press, it starts, the burr will start rotating. So when we don't want burr to work, so then what we do, we automatically remove our foot from the foot pedal. So with the intention of stopping the burr. But it doesn't stop immediately. It still rotates for a while before it stops in the brush motor with a brush. Whereas brushless motors, what they do is, when you don't want to drill, you remove your foot pedal, immediately the burr will stop working. So that is the advantage of brushless motor. Am I clear now?
Yeah. The next question is from Kavita Sasdev. She asks whether comment on clockwise and anti-clockwise rotation of the drill.
Yeah. So now we are going to tell you in the next this one. That is, so you see, where most of the times our bone work will do when it runs towards the right side is a clockwise. We don't keep in the anti-clockwise. We keep the burr to rotate in anti-clockwise only when we work in very, very important areas, like when we want to decompress the labyrinthine segment of facial nerve or over the dura only, we keep our burr to rotate onto the anti-clockwise direction. Otherwise, for all routine bone work, it has to run on the clockwise direction.
Yeah, clockwise is basically for cutting the bone. Yeah. And anti-clockwise is just a smoothing, or especially when I have breathers to coagulate that. We got that point. One more question from Mitesh Patel is, can we use formalin tablets inside the microscope cover for sterilization?
Yes, you can use. But only thing is, you have to change the formalin tablets very often, because the formalin tablets, whatever you keep, is going to become a powder in 7 days time, 7 to 10 days time maximum. So once the formalin tablets becomes powder, they get stuck to the lens. Once it gets stuck to the lens, our lens is very expensive, it gets spoiled. So the best way to protect our microscope is that you use the disposable covers available in the market for your microscope, which will cost very, very less price, maybe around 75 rupees to 100 rupees per each one. You can just throw it out once you use it.
Yeah, that's all questions for now.
Yeah, so now we'll now move on to the most important thing, the burrs. So now, see, these are burrs are rotating instruments that we keep in the handpiece to remove the bone, to drill the bone we use. So these burrs are classified into various types, that is, according to its composition. They are stainless steel burrs, tungsten carbide burrs are available. According to the purpose, they are classified as cutting burrs, diamond burrs, and polishing burrs. According to the length of the burr, they are classified as long, short, and medium ones. And according to the motion, they are classified as clockwise and anti-clockwise. But we don't have these burrs with us, and we don't use them. But they use in the dental work, and we don't use in our practice. But there is a classification is there in the textbook. So now, according to the shape of the burr, so now this very important, burrs are available. The round burrs are available. We have inverted conical burrs are available. Conical burrs, cylindrical, disc burrs, and long cylindricals are available. Let's see each one, how they look like and what are the indications. So now let's see, this is the round burr. This is the one that we are commonly using in our otology practice, followed by a cylindrical burr, and the conical burr, an inverted burr. And these are the various types of burrs available in the market to us. So now, let's see the cutting burrs. So the cutting burrs are the ones which we use the most, because they are very aggressive in bone removal, and they are available in a variety of sizes and shapes of steel and carbide burrs. And there are various brands available. It is you to choose which is the ideal one and best one in the market. It comes by, you know, all the experience. They are available as long, short, and medium burrs. So now let's see what are the ideal ones for our dissection. So now see, the burrs have got some parts which are very difficult and easy to understand. So now they divide, three parts are there. Number most important thing is the head one. This is the head, this is the neck, and this is the shaft, are also called as shank of the burr. So now the size of the burr is dictated by the size of the head of the burr. So this is the size of the burr. If I say 5 millimeter burr, that means the head is measuring 5 millimeters. If I say 5 millimeters, 70 mm burr, that means the head is 5 millimeter, but the length is 70 millimeters. So burr has got head, neck, and the shank or shaft. So now see this diameter, the thickness of the shank. So this thickness of the shank is fixed. This thickness of the shank is fixed. It's almost universal for all the burrs, and the shank diameter is, this is a fixed one for majority of the burrs, 2.125 millimeters. Suppose if your shank diameter is thicker than this, this will not fit to your routine burst. So that you have to understand. Okay, this is the parts of the burr. So now the shank is the one which defines the length of the burr. So the shank length varies, the burr length varies from 25 millimeters to 90 millimeters. So, but for our practice, 25 millimeters will become too short a burr and 90 millimeters will become too long a burr for otology surgery. Okay, 90 mm burr is required in rhinology surgery if you want to do DCR and other things, but not in otology. But what we use in our practice, commonest is between 50 and 70 millimeter. So this is the shank diameter. So again, one more point is that burr will have a notch in the down. There's a notched burrs are available for high speed otology burrs have got a latch or a notch down so that it will fit in the handpiece nicely. So that is the thing that we must know. See, these are the cutting burrs available from 7 millimeters max to 0.6 millimeters. So these are the available diameters for us in the market. You can see the head of the each burr, it reduces. Okay, then we see often these burrs in the market. So these are actually designed for the dental work. Actually, they use for a metal cutting or processes cutting in the lab they use. But these burrs are not originally intended for otology use, but still we use, because you must remember that these dental burrs are not available more than 40 millimeters. Okay, you remember that. These are very short burrs available. But the advantage is they're very, very aggressive in cutting. Okay, that's, you have to understand that is very aggressive in cutting. And these are available in very short length. They are not available as a very long ones, because the very purpose of this is not for otology, but for dental work. We are using it in the surgery. So next comes, we have available this type of long burrs like this, crisscross the teeth they have. The advantage is that these are used nicely for the canalplasty. So these are the burrs which we use for the canalplasty. See, these are the various kinds of shapes available with the dental people. Remember that the shank is very small. So that is the only disadvantage. Otherwise, these are tungsten carbide TC burrs. They're long lost and they cut the bone very aggressively. You have to remember that they are very short. That is the only disadvantage. So now, so once we know the cutting burrs, so now see, cutting burrs have got teeth here. Can you see this teeth? This is the teeth of the burr. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the teeth vary from burr to burr. So the advantage of, if we have more teeth, the bone removal is not very aggressive. If you have less teeth, there will be more aggressive bone cutting is there. But disadvantage of having less teeth is the burr will start jumping. That means it will not stay at one point. It will keep on jumping. That's called eccentricity of the burr. So that you have, whenever you use a burr with less teeth, you will notice that the burr will keep on jumping from the place where you operate. That's very difficult to control it. So now, so let's see what is the rake angle. See, this is the teeth. So that when the teeth rotates towards and clockwise, those are the first surface which rotate like this, takes the burden of removing the bone. So that is called as rake face. So the angle with which it makes with the other side is the rake angle. And this is the clearance face. So we have rake angle, clearance angle, rake face and clearance face. So if you know that there are something like this, there are again 10 types of angles like this in each burr. So edge angle, so many things are there. But these are not required really for us to know. This is all given in the dental books. It's not given in our otology book. So if you know that there are something like rake angle, clearance angle, and there's enough for us. And please remember that the less number the teeth has got, the more it jumps. That you should remember that. Next is, this is what I was talking about. This has got a notch here. So these notched burrs are used for otology, high speed otology burrs. So these notched burrs can be used with a routine drill, but you cannot use a routine burr without notch for a high speed drill. Vice versa is not possible. So please remember that the high speed, the burr bits which are designed for high speed otology drill systems can also be used with the routine burrs, routine drill systems, but the routine drill bits cannot be used for a high speed otology burr. Please remember that. So now please remember that this is the head of the burr is the working part of the instrument. All this will go into the shank will go into the handpiece. So this head will, the size will define the size of the burr. Yeah. So next let's see what is diamond burr. So the diamond burrs are available as a fine diamond burr like this and coarse diamond burr like this. You can see very well here that there are particles which are protruding beyond the surface of the burr. They are very coarse. The advantage of coarse cutting burr is that, so this is coarse diamond burr, is it removes the, it smoothens the cavity very fast and removes the bone like a cutting burr, but it doesn't damage the underlying structure. But the disadvantage of coarse burr is it spoils. That means we should, wear and tear is more. You have to often replace the coarse burr. Whereas a fine burr can be used for a long time. But the greatest advantage of this is that you can drill on any important structures without even, without damaging the structures most of the times. Diamond burrs. That is the important thing. But the disadvantage is it produces a lot of heat. So that means when you use a diamond burr, it has to be irrigated, a lot of irrigation is required to reduce the heat that generated by the diamond burr. So again, diamond burrs are available from 7 millimeters to 0.5 millimeters. Depending on the size of the burr, you can use where all you want to use for a given area. You can choose. It is you that you have to choose which is the correct burr for your area that you are going to use. So now we have again polishing burrs like this available. These are all used for a dental purposes. See, these burrs are very, very good for otology work, one for a finishing of the cavity. When you want to smoothen the cavity after a canal wall down mastectomy, so these are very good burrs available for us to reduce the all ridges and hills and caves and make the smooth cavity. So these are the polishing burrs. So now what are the, let me have some water. Let's see, the diamond burrs are used near important structures like facial nerve, dura, sigmoid sinus, jugular bulb and semicircular canals. Because even if you touch the structure, important structure with your diamond burr, it is not going to damage the underlying structure. That's the greatest advantage of diamond burr. But it produces a lot of heat. So that means you have to use a lot of saline to irrigate that in that area. So another advantage of using a diamond burr is whenever there is a bleeding from the bone. So if you drill over that point, so when you want to stop a bleeding from the bone, so you should not irrigate that area. You should just directly drill that area without saline irrigation. The bleeding will stop from the bone. That's the advantage because it pushes the bone into the bleeding area and then the bleeding will stop. So that's the advantage of diamond burr. So once we know that, there are cutting burrs, diamond burrs, or striped ones. So now we must also be aware that there are curved burrs like this available. So these are very, very expensive. The disadvantage is they're expensive, number one. Number two, they can be used only with a specific system of the drill system. It cannot be used with any ordinary drill system. So it is to be used in a specialized handpiece. So the biggest advantage is it is useful when you want to do a very deep area where you want to drill. It's very good. And canal plasty is excellent. But only thing is, it's a little expensive, but it lasts longer also. So that's the advantage. We must know that the curved burrs are also available in the market. Govindraj, any doubts so far about the burrs?
No, no, it is very clear. And once you've finished, I think we'll take a few questions which is there. In the.
No, if they have any comments or anything you want to add, you can add. No.
Yeah.
About
yeah.
the burrs.
There's a question from Hussein. Yeah. The size of a burr is dictated by diameter or length of the head?
Diameter of the head, not the head diameter. Length. Diameter length. Of the head.
Yeah.
Not there's the length more, of the burr.
See, one more question from Suman Thapa. They want to know what are the minimal requirement of burrs to do cortical mastectomy, sizes of burrs they meant.
See, I just want to make everyone clear that whenever you start a temporal bone dissection or a live surgery, please have one set of burrs. Please have one set of the burrs. I repeat, because if you buy 2-3 burrs and operate, so it will not be, see when you want to have a smaller one, so you cannot go and get it at that point of time. So before you start your dissection, it's better to have a set of burrs containing all the sizes. But if you ask me specifically to do cortical mastectomy only, if you have 4, 5, 6 of cutting burrs, that's enough to do a mastectomy. Am I clear?
Yeah, man. Yeah, but as you said, you should have all the sizes ideally. Because we don't know at what point of time, sometimes if you anticipate a cortical, sclerotic mastoid and the disease is in a critical area, then you need a small burst, or sometimes just cortical mastoidectomy, you can't predict that it will end up with a cortical mastoidectomy. You may need to do epitympanotomy. So ideally to start any surgery, you should have all different size of burst, cutting as Dr. J.P. Reddy is telling. The next question is, they want to know the size of the burst, tip burst, to be used in stapes and cochleostomy.
Yeah, you must see for to do stapes surgery, the best thing is you must have a skeeter drill, Portoflex skeeter drill. They are available with 0.3, 0.4, 0.5 diameter. They are available. Yes. They can be used.
Yeah, stapes surgery still can be. We can use a contraangle. Contraangle comes handy in case of if you don't have a skeeter drill.
Yeah.
And the size ideally you should have is 0.4 and 0.6.
Yes.
And especially for cochleostomy, the maximum diameter of cochlear electrode is 0.9 and depends on each different company. So you should have 1 mm or 0.9 mm drill. So you should make a fenestra of 0.9 mm. So you should have an ideal size of that size. Okay. At times we use a skeeter of 0.6 and 0.9 to make the fenestra of 0.9. So 0.9. So ideally, the sizes of the drill depends on what is the fenestra or the cochleostomy you have to make. So it will be less than 1 millimeter.
Yeah.
So one more. Yeah. Okay. One more question. What is the maximum number of teeth a cutting burr can have?
See, the more number the teeth they have, the less it vibrates, the less it runs. So that is the advantage. It all depends on the make that you buy from the company. See, you cannot dictate how many. So the ideal ones, if they have six or eight teeth, it's very good. But if you have more also, the cutting efficiency will come down, but the stability of the burr is maintained. So now we'll go into the next. The most important thing is when you drill a bone, you should have always profuse irrigation in the saline, and that should be continuously sucked. So why do you put saline when you drill? Number one is to remove the bone dust. Number two, to reduce the thermal damage to the tissues and cool the surface and keep the area cleaned. So to do that, either you can ask your assistant to put the saline according to the burr that you are going to use. Number one. Number two, you can have a suction cannula of double like this lumen, wherein this one, we are going to connect a saline to that, and this is going to get connected to the suction machine. So when you on the drill, so the saline will come through this port and put onto the tissue that you are going, the bone that you are going to drill, and then it will immediately suck. So you don't require an assistant that time. So that can be done with a suction irrigation cannula. So now Now, what we should not so do, do's and don'ts. What we should not do, what should do is that, now you see. So once you are familiar with the all the tools that you have, so now you must know how to hold them and how to use them. So now let's see. So what we can do. So now, if you're a right-handed surgeon, you must hold your drill in your right hand, in dominant hand. You cannot hold drill in your left hand and then suction in the right hand. Please remember that your dominant hand will hold the, if you are a left-hander, the drill will be held in the left hand and the suction in the right hand, otherwise. So now right hand will hold the drill and the left hand will suction. So now you see this, how the suction is held like this. This is very important. And then you must have the control over the suction. Then next is, when you want to drill the early part of the section, you must select a largest burr possible and the short length you must use. If you use a small burr and a long one, it will jump, number one. Number two, problem with the small burr is it will plunge inside the structures. It's very dangerous. So you take a cutting burr of short length and largest possible burr in the early part of dissection. When you want to do deeper dissection, take one which is a long shaft, preferably diamond. Yeah. So now, when you want to drill, always you see that structure in the perpendicular axis, number one. Number two, hold the handpiece like a pen or pencil. And one more important thing is, when you want to drill area, first start your drill. Then you take that rotating drill onto the structure that is going to be drilled. Don't do the otherwise. That means don't keep your burr on a structure and then start pressing your foot pedal. So then the burr will jump from there to other area. So always you start the drill, then you touch the area of drilling. That's very important. And always use the largest possible burr for a given area, because the small burr may slip or plunge. Plunge means it will just go into the tissue. That's very dangerous. So now, when you want to drill on the dural plate like this, this is a dural plate. This is the posterior bony canal wall, and this is a sigmoid sinus. See, your drill will always be like this, like this, like this. That means long axis of the structure here, from here, to here, here to here, like this, but never like this. If you do like this, it may transect the structure. That you must understand the drilling techniques. So now, another point is, always use the drill with the side of the burr, not with the tip. So I have seen many beginners in the time of temporal bone dissection, they will try to cut the bone with the tip of the burr, so that they press the burr against the burr and they press the foot pedal with the intention to cut the bone very fast. That is, cannot be done with the tip. If you try to cut the bone with the tip, it produces a lot of heat, but it doesn't cut and it damages the burr bit. It damages the handpiece. And the most important thing is, it will damage your fingers. That means on a long run, if you do wrong technique of drilling, you will start developing tremors. You will damage your fine movements of the hand. So you remember that, always use, the burr like the side of the burr with the flutes. Keep on, I'll show you how the live, how you must drill. And if you take two big burr for a given area, it goes and touches unwanted areas and it produces a lot of dural dehiscences also. And two small one, it will go and plunge inside. And when you are, see, your idea is to use the head of the burr to cut the bone. But when you touch the shaft with the, your shaft, that shank also will touch some tissue. So then it produces a lot of heat. So please be careful that your shaft should not touch the bone or tissue when you try to drill with your head. So now, always your drill must start from risky areas to safer areas, number one. Number two, when you are working near the ossicles, please use a cuirass to remove the bone than drills, so that suppose if your drill bit touches the inner ossicles, it may produce a lot of damage to the inner ear. And always wash thoroughly once you finish the surgery to remove all the bone dust. So to avoid fixation of the ossicular chain with the remnant bone, which is left in the middle ear. So that's very important. So you must avoid touching the important structures. So now once you start using the drill, keep on move your drill from here to here, here to here. No, don't press the drill against the bone with the intention to cut the bone. Always move like this, the side flutes, the bone will get cut very easily. So that is the secret of drilling. So now let's see, now is all theory, now we have seen. Now let's see how the you must use the drill. So the moment you are starting a surgery or temporal bone dissection, now first thing what we must do is you must check the your drill, whether it is rotating clockwise or anti-clockwise. In this situation, your assistants may, without your knowledge, they may change the direction of the burr. So this is, you must see that. So now you see this, is now the burr is rotating anti-clockwise. That means the burr is rotating towards my left side. So if I don't check this and I start using the burr, I will curse that I am not doing the surgery or dissection properly, or this drill bit is not functioning well, and I will keep on pressing against the bone and damage so many things before. So always it's a good practice to check which side the burr is rotating. Now I made the burr to rotate on the north clockwise direction. See this? So now it is ready for drilling. So first step is, you please check your drill whether it is moving right or left. Next, what is the direction of drilling? So these are the most practical tips I am going to give you. You see now how I am drilling. So now this is a high speed drill with a cutting burr, steel burr. So now the direction of drilling is, you know, this is the posterior bony canal wall. This is the external canal. This is the dural plate going to be, this is the supra. This is the superior supramastoid crest, and this is the sigmoid sinus. So now we have created a triangle of attack. So now we see how I am drilling. So my drill is moving from anterior to posterior. See, I am drilling the long axis of, see, external canal, bony canal, long axis of, see, long. So I am using the tip of the burr. You see, my burr is moving from one area to another, and in between, lot of saline is kept and it is being washed out very nicely. See now. So this is how you must drill. See, from, don't press at one point. See how my drill is moving from one area to other. My suction is working simultaneously to remove the burr, and simultaneously the assistant is pouring the saline. So this is how all this must be synchronized at once when you drill. Your right hand, your left hand should be well coordinated like this, to get into the play that. See, now I have opened the, this is actually an unedited video. So how much time we have taken to reach the antrum? It is, we have just taken halfly in time. So how do you know that we have entered into the antrum? So now you can see this is the bulge of the lateral canal will tell you that you are in the antrum. See now, to make a safe entry into the antrum, you must drill between posterior bony canal wall, dural plate and the sinus plate. So you keep on thinning these three bones, three landmarks, and drill the bone in between, then it will take you to the antrum. So from anterior to posterior, perpendicular to the, is a long axis to the a structure that is going to be drilled, is the most important thing that you must learn. So next, when you want to drill from a deeper like this, so I'll be showing. Suppose in this exercise, I am going to do a transmastoid aticotomy. So now you see, my drilling will be from below upwards like this. So this is a risky area. So this risky area means, is, what is risky area is, there is a incus is there, ossicular chain is there. So now my way of drilling is, should be from below upwards, from like this, see. I'm coming below upward, but not above downwards. Always remember that. So from below upwards, you must drill. And also when you want to drill, always check. I'll start drill first and then go and touch the area that I want to drill. Suppose I am drilling here. I want to drill here. My burr should not touch this wall. That is how I must select my burr. I felt that this burr is a, I want to drill here. My burr should not touch the incus. Remember that. That is a selection of the burr. If you select a bigger burr than this, what this will do, this will go and touch an unwanted area. That unwanted structure is this ossicular chain, and the patient is going to develop a, this is all about the burring. So now you must know what is the correct size burr that is required for a given area. If you can judge that, you are the master. So now see, my burr, I want to drill here, this is not touching here. So this is a 2 mm burr I have taken, and I'm drilling from below upwards. So now this ossicular chain is there. I'm thinning the bony canals with the side of the burr, and simultaneously I'm making my room towards the anterior attic space. See, when dealing with the important structure here, so what I am doing carefully, you observe here, I am protecting this important structure with my suction tip, so that by inadvertently my burr touches this, there will be in between the important structure and my burr, I will keep my suction tip. This can also be used, the suction tip can also be used as a guard to protect the burr touching from the important structure. So that is, again, to recapture it, from above, below, upwards you must do. So keep thinning this bone and dural plate until towards anteriorly, then you will enter into the transmastoid aticotomy. So this is how you must drill at this point. So now, see, when I ideally, when you do a canalplasty, you must use a diamond burr. Okay, that's very important. That's number one. Number two, when you want to do canalplasty, you must protect your skin with a cotton ball or with a some foil of a catgut or something like that. You must protect. But these two were not taken at this point of time, and the surgeon is using the cutting burr to do canalplasty fast. So that's what I want to tell you, that there is nothing like fast in the otology. So the slow is also not done. There is an ideal speed is the one. The ultimately, whether you do tympanoplasty in 40 minutes or 2 hours, it doesn't matter to the patient. But the patient wants the final result to be the best one. So take your time and then do. See, now when I'm using a cutting burr like this, the skin of the external artery canal and the tympanic membrane were shattered into pieces like this. Of course, we can even reconstruct again to the near normal, but this should never happen. See, initial part of your career, these things will happen, but please take care that this should not happen. So to prevent this, what you can do is, you use a diamond burr and you protect the skin flaps with the, so anyway, we can reconstruct again the same skin like this, but it takes more of your time. So the never use a wrong burr. The wrong burr is the one. See, if you want to do canalplasty, always do with the diamond burr. Don't do with the cutting burr. So now next is, when you want to drill on the facial nerve, how we drill? Now see, now this is a case of cholesteatoma where modified radical mastectomy is being done. So now I am removing the most important part of the bone, is the inferior canal wall hump here, posterior part, is very important area. See, now when I am drilling near the facial nerve, I have taken a large cutting diamond burr. See, now there is bleeding here from the bone. I will show you how it will get stopped. See, there is a bleeding here. Can you see that? So the immediately when I start drilling with the diamond burr, again you see how the drilling can be, see, is that bone is bleeding here at this point, which can be, see, this is the one which is effectively controlled with the diamond bar. See how the diamond, this is a coarse diamond bar. So with the diamond bar, your facial canal should be lowered like this. This is how you must lower the facial canal up to this level. See, almost we have come to the facial nerve here. So this is how you must drill with the a diamond bar. See, when you want to drill anterior canal wall to do canalplasty, so how do you drill? See, this is very common indication for us to do canalplasty is a canal hump here. So having a canal hump here, we cannot do grafting properly here. So what we have to do is that you must elevate the skin from all around. See now how I am drilling. I have taken a suitable diamond bar. I am drilling like this, but not above downwards. So what is the danger here? Always there is an underlying structure is there whenever you drill in any particular area. Here is the temporomandibular joint is there. You should be very careful that you should not expose the temporomandibular joint. See now, once I remove a cantilever canal hump, so I can see the graft everywhere. Very nicely it is draped. So this is a canalplasty is an integral part of ear surgery. We must learn that, and we must also learn how to reduce the anterior canal wall hump with the diamond. So now when you want to drill near the sinus tympani, you all know that sinus tympani is a very important area where diseases usually recurrences are common because the disease is left over here. So now let's see how we drill here. See the selection of the bar is such that my stapes is here. You can see the intact stapes. So I selected a bar to remove the bony covering of the sinus tympani, but my bar will not touch. See, this bar should not touch the stapes. Suppose if I take if I would have taken a bigger bar than this, it would have got, it will go and hit the stapes. So that is how you must select the bar. See, I have removed the sinus tympani. All the, now you can see that is a pyramid. There is a pyramid. So I removed all the bony covering and removed the disease. So this is a, I am doing intact canal wall tympanoplasty in this patient for a limited cholesteatoma. So I expose the sinus tympani with a small diamond bar. So now, what is very important now, let's see. So this is a case of a cholesteatoma I was doing for extensively pneumatized mastoid. And I was drilling near the tip here. So the sigmoid sinus got exposed, which I did not see inadvertently. And it has happened in my own hand. The bar went and touched the sigmoid sinus. You carefully observe here. The sigmoid sinus is going here. I know that sigmoid sinus is there. I have drilled out the tip. So here I exposed the, see, my bar, I exposed the, see here I exposed the sigmoid sinus, and which got unnoticed, and with, because I was using a very high speed drill, so it got hit, it went and hit the sigmoid sinus, and you can see the end result, how it is bleeding. See, there was a rent in the sigmoid sinus, it started bleeding heavily. So now let's see how to control this. See, the moment you hit the sigmoid sinus like this, first thing is don't get panicky. Take a ribbon gauze like this and just press against the bone like this for 1 to 2 minutes. Then relax, don't get panicky. Then next, what to do is, the moment you remove this, again it is going to bleed. It is not going to get controlled. See how it is bleeding. See, you just press for some time. So next, you take a very big size, see the size of the gel foam, like this. Slowly replace this gauze piece with the gel foam like this. See, you can take gel foam or Surgicel. I use gel foam. See, keep this gel foam pressed against the bone and keep on moving millimeter by millimeter. And remove this, see, and press this against the bone for 5 to 10 minutes time. Don't remove it. 5 to 10 minutes time, the bleeding will stop. It will get stuck there. Only thing is, if you take a small one, it may go inside and become an emboli. Don't do that. Take a bigger one always and press this against the bone for 5 to 10 minutes by watch. See, now the bleeding is stopped. The moment this gets dislodged, again it may bleed, but keep a soft tissue like this. And whenever a complication occurs in your hand, first thing is, please don't get panicky. Think how to manage it. Don't run away, don't pack it and just come out, and don't run away from a complication. Please control it. If you can't control it, just press it and stop bleeding temporarily. Ask for help, call some senior, or if no senior is available, just make a phone call and then know how to manage. So like this, you can control the bleeding. and don't stop the surgery because already you have created a complication. Don't stop the surgery. You complete the surgery. See, the surgery is done for cholesteatoma. So now what I did, I controlled the bleeding. Rest of the areas were not drilled. I drilled the rest of the areas. I did aciculoplasty and did the grafting. And finally, what I took a posteriorly based musculoperiosteal flap. And this flap has done two jobs for me. Number one, it obliterated the tip of the mastoid. The second one is it protects the exposed sinus so that it will not bleed when somebody tries to clean or something like that. So that is how this patient was managed. So now when you are working near the stapes foot plate or when you want to do cochleostomy, your burr should not be more than 1000 RPM. Somebody were asking this question. This is the answer for that. When you want to do superficial bone work, 20 to 40,000 RPM is ideal. When you want to deeper fine work like canaloplasty or something like that, it is 5 to 10 RPM. So all this, I already told what is variable speed switch. So even if you keep at 20,000 RPM, if you just mildly press your foot pedal, it will rotate only for 4 to 5,000 RPM. Unless you press to its fullest extent. So advantages of variable foot switch is that. So again, to tell you, use the side of the burr, not the tip. And steady, smooth strokes you must give, not press against the bone. And always drill parallel to the structures. Don't use the tip of the burr. That is very important. You should not do like this. This is how you must do. What should not be done is never work in a deep hole like this. See what has happened. See, one of the PG students were doing this surgery. You see what he has done. So he was trying to make enterotomy by a small hole and he entered directly into sigmoid sinus and there was a torrential bleeding was there. So you see how, see how it is bleeding. We just directly made a hole into the sigmoid sinus. What we did in this patient was, we put a pack like this and then drilled on either side, made into a big cavity and then controlled the bleeding in the same way as the previous case. So now, before we go on to either temporal bone dissection or live surgery, we must have a good microscope, instrument, burrs and drills, drill bits, and drill systems, and we must be familiar with all these things. Just if you acquire this, you cannot do surgery, but you must know how to use them safely on a patient. And the largest possible burr you have to use for a given area, and the diamond burr should be reserved for important structures and delicate structures, and drill always parallel to the structures with the profuse irrigation, especially when you use diamond burr. And I again repeat that please protect your back from getting damage, and then you need a lot of years ago to practice, protect your back. So that's very important. That means you have a very good surgeon chair when you do dissection or surgery. That's very important. So now I can say that the skills are learned over a period of time. And these skills are learned over time and it requires repeated practice. The repeated practice makes your brain neural pathway strong so that it is like driving a car. So, you know, when you drive initially in your initial days, when you learn, you are able to see which gear the car is that you have to look at the gear. And gradually, when you become more and more experienced with your hand where it is, you will know which gear you are running. And even more experience, you can say by listening to the sound of the engine, you can say which gear you are running. So the otology surgery is just like driving a car so that you can give a very good results in the patients. So now just I can conclude by telling you that please understand the normal anatomy of the temporal bone before you go on to the live surgery. And please learn all the art of handling the instruments, microscope, drill, and micro instruments in the temporal bone lab. So please don't take your first steps of learning all these things on the patient because it takes a lot of your time to learn all these things. So if you start learning all these things in the operation room, you will take a lot of time to do surgery. And you get hand and eye coordination, drill control and psychomotor skills. before you go on to the patient. So that's very important. So just I want to remember my old and we went for a course in Italy with friends and teachers. He was Dr. Mario Sanna. In 2007, we had been there. This was way in the 13 years back, along with our team, Dr. Prahalad, Dr. Narayan Jayashankar, and Dr. Vijendra sir, and he was Mario Sanna. And he is the Dr. S.K. Apparao, is our ISO president. He was there along with us. We went as a group of 25 people to Piacenza, Italy for a course in 2007 with Dr. Morvani sir. It was a fantastic course. We all enjoyed it. I just cherished my memories like this with you all. So now, before we say conclude this, please again, you can note my email ID. So we are conducting a lot of temporal bone dissections in our place. You can contact us for registrations in the days to come. And remember that life is full of twists and thrills like bursts, but you have to keep your attitude sharpened with the positive attitude. So we are all facing it very difficult days now in the COVID times that we are not into practice and we are away from our profession. And we are so in the days to come, definitely we'll be doing courses and you're all welcome to our courses. And I thank the moderator, Dr. My friend, Dr. Govindraj, and the organizers of this webinar, Dr. Harsha and his friend, for doing such a wonderful program. Thank you very much. With this,
Yeah, thank you, Reddy. It was a wonderful presentation. You have covered each and every point from basic to, you know, to, from the what the residents have to learn to become a good otologist. So it is everything just covered. Thank you so much.
Yeah. If you have any questions, we can take or
Yeah, I think there's not much questions because what are the questions they were raising? You already covered them.
Yeah.
So, and there are a lot of, you know, appreciation from you. For example, Palini Appan from Tiruchi, then your friend Ravi, then Krishnappa BD, Bharati ma'am was there online and she was very, you know, she was very interactive in the session, answering, clearing most of the questions.
Oh.
Yeah. BD Krishnappa was there. A lot of them, they're very happy and a lot of, you know, they appreciated the talk.
Yeah.
Because it covered the basics from everything, each and every point you have covered very clearly.
Yeah, I request people, whoever have got any doubts, they can even clarify by mail to me. And tomorrow, we have a session in the morning wherein we'll be showing how to drill and what are the different exercises. And we made it into the temporal bone dissection into two parts. Tomorrow, we'll have a step one, part one, and then part one followed on the Wednesday. Harsha?
Yes, sir. I'm here, sir.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Yes. Sir.
Anything you want to clarify or anything, doubts or anything?
Sir, just I think, are you able to see the screen, sir? My screen?
Yeah, I am seeing.
Yes, sir. So tomorrow we have session two at 11 o'clock Indian time, which is 5.5 hours ahead the Greenwich Mean time. So we are all welcome to join us for the actual dissection exercises, part one, which we'll be doing tomorrow at 11 o'clock. With this, we conclude for today's session. Thank you, Dr. JP sir and Dr. Govindraj sir for moderating this session. It's a really informative and excellent talk. And we hope to see you again tomorrow at 11 o'clock.
Yeah, Harsha.
Yes.
This program was recorded, no?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll send it to you.
Yeah, thank you, boss.
Yes,
thank you.
Good night.
Good night.